Well, March 2021 performance figures beat our phenomenal ones from March 2020. This is my March 2021 solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance here in the UK, along with our Tesla Model 3 and Kona electric costs and usage. So stay tuned. Hi, John here and welcome. Back in my studio this month. If you recall, last month's stats were filmed in the house because I forgot to turn on the heating in my photo studio. This is not a problem anymore as I've upgraded to an 1800 watt far infrared heater and removed the old portable oil heater. I've suspended the new heater from the ceiling. It's controllable from a remote or via an app. There's a link down below in the description if you want to know more about it. But suffice to say, it's nice and toasty in here. I'm going to take you through our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance for the month of March 2021. Plus the usual stats, usage information for the Tesla Model 3, the Hyundai Kona Electric, and the My Energy Eddy and Zappy. In the description down below is a list of all of our components of our system, so please have a look down there if you're not familiar with our system and our setup. On 1st of March 2021, we had a FIT payment come through of £254.45 for generation from December to February, which was nice. Our next one is due on the 1st of June. So let's get into the stats. So the solar PV generation numbers, spring has certainly sprung. We've got longer daylight hours. Sun is higher in the sky with extra warmth, but you still get those cooler temperatures, which is sort of perfect for good solar generation. We now start our solar day around 6:20 a.m. That was before the clocks went forward on Sunday the 28th of March here in the UK. Post clocks going forward means our generation starts generally around 7:20 in the morning. The end of the solar day can be as late as 10 past 7 in the evening, and that's after the clocks have gone forwards. We hit peak generation of 6.4 kilowatts on three occasions during the month, and that's on our theoretical 6 kilowatt of inverters. We have a 3.8 and a 2.2. They often produce around 10% over the stated rating, more so on the solar edge rather than the SMA Sunny Boy inverter, which is a 3.81. So in March 2021, we produced a total of 473 kilowatt hours from our two separate PV arrays. We had an average daily solar generation of 15.2 kilowatt hours for the month. We weren't even close to the March 2020 total of 695 kilowatt hours. That was a stunning month. It generated 32% more solar energy than the month just gone. So phenomenal. Please do drop your generation totals and PV array size in the comments down below, because it really does provide a good comparison for people. And I obviously like to see them as well. So if you would do that, that would be awesome. Thank you. Let's have a look at the breakdown of the two arrays. Our 4 kilowatt array produced 298 kilowatt hours, and our newer 2.34 array produced 175 kilowatt hours. And you can clearly see there the month by month generation in solar growth. Let's have a look at the Tesla Powerwall and solar contribution to our overall self-power. We were 60% self-powered for the Powerwall and solar contributions. As you can see in the stack chart there, 34% came from solar generation and 26% came from the Powerwall. Enough to say about that, really. This chart is our percentage of self-power during the peak and off-peak time period, supplied again from a Powerwall and or solar. Peak time period is set within the Tesla Powerwall app from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. and off-peak is set from half past midnight to 7:30 in the morning. The remainder of the day is on a normal rate. The numbers shown in this chart represent the percentage of the home's energy usage supplied by either battery or solar, rather than pulling from the grid. The months along the bottom are only populated with data when we are in cost-saving mode with the Powerwall. The red columns represent the four-hour peak of 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. every day, a recurring theme of 97% for the time during that four-hour peak that we were on battery and or solar panel with no pull from the grid, which leaves that remaining 3% of energy being pulled from the grid over the course of the month. Extracting the smart meter data from the OctoWatch dog app, so mouthful, shows that the 3% grid pull equated to 5.32 kilowatt hours over the month for a cost of £1.36. The green column represents the off-peak time between 12:30 and 7:30 in the morning. And during that time, we were on battery, and or solar, but it wouldn't be and or solar, on battery for 25% of the time. I predicted last month that we will see this percentage grow as the months progress towards spring and summer, and there is the proof. I guess the main reason for this is the Powerwall is charging less often during off-peak. There's usually sufficient solar activity during the day to keep it topped up, well into that off-peak time. I have noticed a behaviour with my system which is also worth sharing. We're now starting to have solar generation past 4 p.m. 4 p.m., if you recall, is the start of the peak period. Now, this time slot is plugged into the Powerwall as we're set on cost-saving mode, which means up until the start of the peak period, the Powerwall is happy for the house to pull from the grid if it needs to when there's insufficient solar to fulfill the needs. However, past 4 p.m., up till 8 p.m, it will do its utmost to prevent grid pull. So at 4 p.m, something seems to happen with the Powerwall. For example, if we are charging one of the cars on excess solar up till 4 p.m, with the My Energy Zappy set on Eco Plus Plus mode, it will charge the car only using excess solar with no grid pull. When 4 p.m. is reached, the Zappy will then start to pull power from the Tesla Powerwall as well as the solar excess and ramp up to a maximum of its 7 kilowatts. If the solar production is low, the Zappy will pull the maximum 5 kilowatt load that the Powerwall can supply. So the Zappy isn't really able to distinguish where the power is coming from, apart from knowing it's not from the grid or from solar. It does, however, see it as green energy and records it as such. I can only put this behaviour to the Tesla Powerwall. At 4 p.m. when it goes into peak rate, it changes its priority not to pull from the grid unless there's an absolute need. So the Zappy must see this available power source in the battery come online at 4 p.m. and then start to use it to charge the car. I'm wise to it now, so I keep my eye on it if I'm charging the car at 4 p.m. from excess solar, because I know it's going to start to also pull from the battery. If the Tesla Powerwall was in self-powered mode, I doubt this behaviour would happen. I tend to actually use it to my advantage and let the Zappy continue to charge the car until it's dumped about 10 to 20% from the battery. Then I stop the car charging, and then with the excess solar, it refills the battery, hopefully. Anyway, thought I'd share that insight to you, just in case you have the same sort of setup. So have a look at the year-on-year. So this chart compares the months of March going back to 2012. 2012 to 2019 totals are for the original 4 kilowatt system. The 2020 onward figures are for both arrays combined. If you recall, the original 4 kilowatt array produced 298 kilowatt hours in March 2021, and the new array achieved 175 kilowatt hours. The Powerwall had an 87% round-trip efficiency for the month, for what it managed to store versus what it was able to supply, we stored 277 kilowatt hours and it supplied 242 kilowatt hours. This is the day by day chart, which gives you a bit more information on what happened day by day. The legend, as ever, is blue is house usage, yellow is solar, orange is export to the grid, and red is import from the grid. Solar activity was fairly good overall, peaking towards the last few days of the month. Our highest generation day was 37.2 kilowatt hours on the 30th of March. The lowest was 2.8 kilowatt hours on the 10th of March. The export to the grid is always in small amounts spread over the month. The highest export was 3.4 kilowatt hours on March the 9th. We had some high usage days during the month. The high peaks of home usage coincide with the cheap overnight agile rates, where we could be charging the car, running the glass kiln, and the Powerwall would have also been charging. Although the Powerwall has been charging less and less over the remaining days of the month, often not charging at all overnight because there's been a good solar day the previous day. Scroll down and have a look at the overall totals. This chart shows the overall totals for the four data sources we've just looked at in the day by day. House usage in blue is perhaps the key one to focus on, 980.8 kilowatt hours for the month. Interesting that the solar total is now picking up a lot of the gap, meaning that our grid usage is reducing. And we'll have a look at that in a little more detail in the following charts. In fact, let's do that now. So this chart shows our average daily house usage and our average daily grid usage over the month. The average daily house usage was down for the third month on the trot at 31.6. That's the blue line at the top. The daily average we pulled from the grid was also down for the third month on the trot at 17.7 kilowatt hours. That's the red line. We sent 33 kilowatt hours of excess solar generation back to the grid in March, which is sort of on par on previous months. Our monthly total from the grid, so this chart tracks what we pull from the grid each month. In March, we dropped down the amount we pulled to 547 kilowatt hours. And it's nice to see that falling away despite some days where we had really large grid pulls. And remember that although the total may seem like a lot of electricity being consumed and therefore expensive, it needs to be coupled with the unit costs for that power. Looking at the Octopus Compare app and the Octopus Watch app, our average unit cost for electricity was 10.44 pence per kilowatt hour for the month, which works out at £58.94 for the month, including the 21 pence daily standing charge. If you've seen my other video about our gas boiler breakdown, I'll put the link up here to it. This means that our electricity consumption from Friday the 5th of March through to Tuesday the 9th of March was higher than normally expected, where we had to switch on a lot more electric heating to keep warm. So over those 5 days, we spent £15.23, which is twice what we would normally use in that short period. This chart is for the Eddy, which heats the hot water by diverting excess solar once the Tesla Powerwall battery is full. March managed to improve on January and February's total at 27 kilowatt hours for the month. I mentioned before, but the totals are rounded up on the Eddy in case you're doing the maths on my figures. The figures shown in the summary columns reflect the readings actually shown on the Eddy screen. Finally, let's go talk about the cars. The Tesla Model 3 covered 655 miles during the month and brought its total mileage to 9,499 miles. We did three supercharging sessions where we added a total of 120.79 kilowatt hours. There was no cost for these charging sessions thanks to those kind individuals who used our Tesla referral code when ordering their cars. They got 1,000 free supercharging miles, as did we. So thank you to those of you who've used it. Hopefully some more of you will also use it if you're ordering a Tesla. That'd be much appreciated. Home charging on the Tesla was 181.22 kilowatt hours, of which 87.99 kilowatt hours was free from excess solar. In February, we only managed to achieve 8% of solar surplus to charge the cars. In March, this has shot up to 37%. That's a saving of just over £9 in electricity costs over the month at our average agile rate of 10.44 pence per kilowatt hour. The 655 miles covered in the Tesla during the month cost us 0.01 pounds per mile. The Kona covered 166 miles for the month and now has a total mileage of 11,270 miles. All charging was done at home, where we added 52.22 kilowatt hours via the Zappy. The mileage covered in the Kona during the month cost us 0.03 pounds per mile. This was more expensive than the Model 3 because we managed to bag any free solar whilst the Kona was plugged in to charge. So please comment, like, share. All of those good actions help to get this video out to more people on YouTube, which in turn helps my channel grow. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next video. All right, take care. Bye.